Hi everyone, this is lecture 21 in analog circuits. In this lecture, I will give some introduction to rectifier circuits. In this, first we will see where we require this rectifier, that is application of a rectifier circuit. Then we will see different types of rectifier circuits. But before that, we need some basics about signal, that is particularly AC signal. So AC signal means alternating current signal. So generally, if someone asks you what is an AC signal means, so we will take it as the sinusoidal signal, which will have a peak value Vm into sine omega t. So what is a Vm? Vm is the peak voltage, we can say, because it is a voltage signal, peak voltage. And what is omega? Omega is the angular frequency, right? If I want period of this signal, we can say omega is equal to 2 pi f, and what is f? F is the frequency of the AC signal frequency. If I want time period, f is equal to 1 by t, right? And when we draw this signal, so we can draw in different ways. If I am drawing with respect to omega t, so we'll have the period is 0 2 pi 2 pi, right? Half period, and this is a full period. This is V of t. AC means, always remember, it will be denoted by all small values, small v and brackets t. And what is the peak value? Vm, and this is the negative peak, minus Vm. And the same signal can be drawn like this also with respect to the t. Then we will have the time period as, this is half period t by 2, then this is t, Vm, that is a peak value, minus Vm, this is V of t. Now in these two signals, we will have positive half cycle and negative half cycle. And remember, this is not starting from 0, it may be coming from minus t, omega t also. Similarly here from minus t also, right? So in this signal also we'll have positive half cycle, then negative half cycle. And what are the parameters we should know about these signals means? Anyway, first one is frequency, or we can say time period. So generally, suppose if I say f is equal to 1 kilohertz, right? Or sometimes you will say 10 kilohertz, or 50 hertz, or 60 hertz, and so on. If I know the frequency, I can find the time period, that is, it will become 1 by f. So 1 by 1 kilo means 1 millisecond. So from this, I can find angular frequency also. Omega is equal to 2 pi into 1 kilo. That means, we can say 2 pi into 1, they actually hertz. So this is 1 kilo radian per second. Right? These are the some parameters. And other parameters we should know about is, what is the DC component in this signal? DC component, or we can say average component. So if I want to find the average component, so that is called VDC or V average, right? So V average means, see, this is extends from minus infinity to infinity. So that's why average means we have to take consider for one period. So average means the total period. So if I want using the omega t, this will become total time period means 2 pi, and we have to integrate from 0 to 2 pi v of t dt. If I am using this signal, the average or DC value will be 1 by time period 0 to t v of t dt, right? If we find this integration value, we will get 0 here also. 0, why? Because if we observe first half period, there is a positive, then the next half period there is a negative, there is plus Vm and minus Vm, both will be cancelled, we will get average value as 0. If we want to integrate this equation, we can get the answer also, that is V of t is Vm sine omega t, right? So this will be 1 by 2 pi 0 to 2 pi Vm sine omega t. Here we have to integrate with respect to d omega t. See, actually this is wrong, d omega t, right? With respect to t means this is dt. So this will come out as Vm by 2 pi integration of sine. What will get? Cos omega t 0 to 2 pi. See, it is looking like sine x dx, right? So we'll get what? Cos x. Vm by 2 pi. So cos omega t in place of omega t, we have to substitute 2 pi. So cos 2 pi minus cos 0. What is cos 2 pi? 1. What is cos 0? 1. 1 minus 1? 0. Similarly, we'll get for this integration also 0. So if you want to try, you can try like this. 1 by t, 0 to t, Vm sine omega t dt. So with respect to t, we have to integrate. So this will come out as 1 by t Vm cos omega t by omega, because we are doing with respect to t, and in place of t we have to substitute capital T. So this will become Vm by omega into t. See, cos, what is omega? Omega is equal to, I can write 2 pi f into capital T in place of small t minus cos 0 anyway. But if you see, f is equal to 1 by t. So f and t will be cancelled. This will become cos 2 pi minus cos 0. We are getting same. So finally the answer will be 0. I think everyone knows this concept, that is average value or DC component of a sinusoidal signal is 0. We have to remember once again before we start the rectifier circuits, because we will find the DC value of the rectified output, right? Or the RMS value of the rectified output, etc. That's why I'm revising one more time. So then we have to find the RMS value, that is root mean square value. So VRMS, so what is the formula? Square root of 1 by the time period t, 0 to t, and v square t dt. Or this also can be written as 1 by 2 pi 0 to 2 pi v square t d omega t and square root r, both are equal. When we calculate this term, we will get the peak value by root 2. If you want, you can verify by doing this calculation, but you can remember directly VRMS of any sinusoidal signal is peak value by root 2, right? So these are the two components we need to remember for this AC signal. What is the, anyway, frequency we can remember easily. What is the average or DC component, and what is the RMS value? Now, why I started this topic is, from the transformers to our homes, we will get AC voltage, or we can say AC power supply. So that AC power supply, if someone asks you what is the voltage in our homes, we will get is, it is 230 volt, but RMS value, remember. And the frequency is 60 hertz. So 60 hertz is the frequency, and 230 volt is the RMS value. If someone asks you what is the peak value of this AC signal or AC voltage, so we know VRMS of AC signal is Vm by root 2. Then Vm will become 230 into root 2 is the voltage. Right? This is the peak value. That means if we draw the AC signal or AC voltage something like this, like sinusoidal signal, the peak value will be 230 root 2 minus 230 root 2, right? V of t, VAC of t. And what is the time period we will get? So frequency is 60 hertz. So this is 1 by 60 is the time period. So half time period means we will get 1 by 120. This is the time. In our homes, all the bulbs and fans will work on the AC power supply. Suppose if I want to operate any electronic equipment like mobile phone or the laptop, so this laptop will work under DC voltage, or we can say DC power supply. All the portable electronic equipments will work under the DC power supply. So if we give AC directly there, like 230 into root 2 like that, so they may damage. So we have to convert this AC voltage or AC power supply to DC power supply to operate electronic equipments, right? Now we need a converter which will convert this AC power supply to DC power supply. That is something like this. Suppose if I say this is a block which will convert AC supply to DC supply. So we say this block is called DC power supply. That is, it will take an AC signal which is very high in voltage, 230 volt root 2 minus 230 root 2, right? And the DC supply or DC voltage means, suppose if this is a VL load voltage, it should be constant for all instant of time. That's why this is called direct current, means it should not change with respect to the time, right? If it is a 5 volt, there should be 5 volt for all time. Suppose 10 volt, 20 volts and so on, right? So all the portable electronic equipments will work either 5 volts or 10 volts and so on, right? So we have to convert this very high voltage, which is AC, to very small voltages, to either 5 to 20 volts range. If you observe in electronic labs, that is electronic devices labs or analog electronic circuits labs, you will see one box which is called DRPS, dual rail power supply. So from the socket we will give the AC signal, which is 230 volt RMS on the 50 hertz or 60 hertz frequency. Then you will see there is a range of 0 to 30 volts range, right? That means this DRPS will give the DC voltage from 0 to 30 volts. So we can keep it 10 volts, 5 volts, 1 volt to maximum 30 volts. So this is one example of this DC power supply. One more is, say, the laptop adapters. So this is adapter. So it will take again the AC supply, and depending on its specifications, it may provide 13.2 volts DC output, and different current ratings will be there, or power ratings, right? So this is also one example of this DC power supply. Now, who will be there inside these boxes so that they will convert AC voltage to DC voltage, right? For that, we will see the block diagram of DC power supply. So this is the block diagram of a DC power supply. In this, we will see 5 different blocks. The first one is transformer, second one is rectifier. So we will use these diodes as a Now, who will be there inside these boxes so that they will convert AC voltage to DC voltage? For that, we need to see the block diagram of a DC power supply. So in this, we will see 5 different blocks. That is, first one is transformer, second one is diode rectifier, third one is filter, fourth one is voltage regulator, and the final stage is load, right? So this load is nothing but any electronic circuit which is working on DC power supply, right? So this is the plus minus VL, load voltage and load current. So this load voltage should be constant. That is, a VL is a DC voltage, right, which is constant for all time. Next, we'll see what each block is doing. The first is transformer. If you recall, we'll have two different types of transformers, that is step up transformer, step down transformer. So step up transformer, what it will do is, it will take lower voltage and it will convert to higher voltage. Step down means it will take higher voltage and it will convert into lower voltage. That is something like this. So I'm drawing the diagram of a transformer. So it will have two coils, or we can say two windings, primary winding, secondary windings, N1 and N2. N1 is the number of turns in primary winding, N2 is the number of turns in the secondary winding. Suppose if this is V1 and this is V2. So what is V2 by V1? Nothing but N2 by N1. Suppose if I want V2 is very much greater than 1, I mean V1. So that means the number of turns in secondary winding should be more than the primary winding. That is, N2 should be greater than N1. Suppose if N2 is equal to 10 times of N1, that is V2 by V1 is equal to 10 into N1 by N1. That means V2 will be 10 times of V1. Suppose V1 is equal to 200 volts, this will become 2000 volts and so on. Suppose if N1 is greater than N2, right? So that means V1 by V2 or V2 by V1 is equal to N2, suppose 10 times of N2. So that means V2 will be V1 by 10 times. That means if V1 is equal to 220 volts, then V2 will be 22 volts only. Now, how to represent the step up and step down transformer is something like this. Suppose N1 more windings and in N2 less number of windings. So this is called step down transformer. So suppose here less number of windings, I mean turns compared to the secondary. So this is step up transformer, right? This is step down transformer. Now, which transformer we required in this DC power supply? Now we know this AC supply is 230 volt RMS 60 Hz frequency, but at the load stage maximum VL is like 5 to 20 volts we will get, 5 volt to 20 volts. So to get this 5 volt to 20 volt, the AC supply should be small compared to this 230 volt. So that's why we required here step down transformer. So here we required step down transformer, which will convert this 230 volt RMS to like a 10 volt RMS or 20 volt RMS, etc. Suppose if I required VL 5 volt, VRMS we required 8 volts. So there should be a step down transformer which will convert this 230 volt RMS to 8 volt RMS. So that I am considering as some VI, right? So this can be represented simply sinusoidal signal. So I will draw the waveforms like this. So here AC supply, like a, how to represent like a sinusoidal signal. Here also we will get like a AC signal only, but the peak value will be reduced here, right? So this is after transformer. Now still it is in AC, right? So which is alternating. Now we have to convert this AC to DC. That means the first block we require is diode rectifier, right? So what is this diode rectifier will do is, it will convert, suppose this is a diode rectifier, it will take this AC signal or AC sinusoid, we can say. So I am considering this is VI, it will have peak values VM minus VM, right? This will convert into, we can say, unipolar waveform. So unipolar means it is having positive half cycle, it is having negative half cycle also. But after passing through this rectifier, it will convert into unipolar waveform, something like this. Right? So this is the output of the rectifier. This is called, also called as pulsating DC or unipolar waveform. And in this waveform, it is having non-zero DC component. Non-zero DC component. That means it is having some DC component, or we can say average component. But in this, the average component or DC component is zero. But after passing through this rectifier, it will convert into a unipolar waveform which is having non-zero DC component. Now, this is the application of rectifier. So where we will use this diode rectifier or simply rectifier circuit? In the DC power supply. So this is the main building block of a DC power supply. Next, we will go back to the block diagram. So after this rectifier, what we got? The waveform something like this, pulsating DC. Now, can we apply this waveform or this voltage directly to the electronic circuit which is working on DC voltage? Suppose there is a circuit which is working on 5 volt DC supply, right? So we got something like this. Suppose it is having some DC component as suppose 5 volt. So can we apply this waveform to this circuit? No. Why? Because see, suppose at one time we got 5 volt, another time we will get maybe 2 volts. So again we may get 4 volts, again we may get 3 volts, etc. So as this is varying, this circuit may damage. So remember, if any circuit is working on DC supply, so it should not fluctuate. Otherwise, the devices or the circuits will damage. So for that reason, we need one more circuit which will convert this pulsating DC to approximately DC. That circuit is called filter. After passing this voltage through this filter, we will get approximately something like this, so which is called approximately DC, but there are some ripples. So these are some ripples, but if we avoid these ripples also, we will get perfect DC. But remember, after this filter we will get approximately DC, but with some ripples, right? With some ripples in the voltage, right? Now, to avoid those ripples, we will pass this waveform through a voltage regulator which is designed using Zener diode. So one of the application of Zener diode is it will be used in design of a voltage regulator. Similarly, one of the important application of a diode is it will be used in design of rectifier, and application of Zener diode is voltage regulator. Now, after passing this voltage through voltage regulator, we'll get a perfect DC, right? Something, if it is a 5 volt, means 5 volts only. Why? Because this Zener diode is in breakdown, it will give a constant voltage of that Zener diode voltage, right? Even though load current is varying, even though input fluctuations are coming, but this voltage regulator will give constant voltage. Now, once we get the constant DC voltage, that DC voltage can be applied to any electronic circuit which is working on DC power supply, right? So these are the internal blocks of a DC power supply. So to convert AC voltage to DC voltage, we require these circuits. Without these circuits, we cannot convert AC to DC. So examples, we can give something like this. If you see mobile charger, so the internal blocks will be like this. So initially there will be a step down transformer, then after that rectification will be done, then filtering will be done. Finally, there will be a voltage regulator to give a 5 volt constant DC or maybe 3 volts constant DC. So mobile chargers and laptop adapters, and anyway in a laboratory, this dual rail power supplies, you will see these internal circuits. Now tell me, what is the application of a rectifier? It will be used in a DC power supply to convert AC to DC voltage. So So our context is diode rectifier. I told you one of the most important application of a diode is it will be used in design of a rectifier. And what is the application of a rectifier? It will be used in DC power supplies, right? Now if I want to give the definition of a rectifier, it is something like this. It is a circuit which will convert an AC sinusoid or AC supply or AC sinusoid to a unipolar waveform which is having a non-zero DC component. Or very simple way we can say like this: it is a circuit which will convert AC to pulsating DC is a rectifier, right? So this is the definition of a rectifier. Now we'll see what are the different types of rectifiers. So the first one is half wave rectifier. The second one is full wave rectifier. So in this we'll have two different types, that is using center tap transformer full wave rectifier, center tap full wave rectifier we can say, and bridge type rectifier, right? So we have to deal with half wave. Then in full wave we will see two different types: center tap and bridge type rectifier. So in this we will see the waveform something like this: only positive half cycles, no negative half cycles. But in these two cases you will see something like this, which is more which is having more DC voltage compared to the half wave rectifier. So when we talk about the rectifiers, we have to talk about the parameters. What are those parameters? Are the first one is, what is the output DC voltage? So V naught, I can say, what is the output DC voltage? And we can also find what is the output RMS, because we'll get pulsating DCs. And one more word is there, that is called peak inverse voltage, right? So these are the most important parameters we need to find when we design or when we discuss the half wave rectifier or full wave rectifier. And other terms are there, like a percentage of regulation and some efficiencies, right? If time permits, we'll also deal with those values, right? But mostly we'll see peak inverse voltage and what is the output DC voltage and what is the RMS value. So that's it. In the next lecture, we'll discuss the half wave rectifier.